All right, can we get started? Sorry to scare you guys. That's pretty strong. It's 5:15, so we want to get started with the panel. It'd be great if you guys can come towards the front side. There are a lot of seats open here. It'd be easier for us to have more of a conversational style panel. All right, how many of you are familiar with a fishbowl? Quick show of hands. All right. So let me quickly help explain what the fishbowl is all about, and then we will get that started. So we want to do a panel, but you know the typical problem with a panel is it's just this people stuck on the panel trying to answer the question over and over, and then it gets boring after a while. So the idea with fishbowl is that you know people here are not fixed. There's always one of the chairs that is left empty, so anyone from the audience can come in and participate in the panel. So when they come in to contribute, someone from the panel has to leave, keeping one chair empty. So at any given point in time, one chair is always empty, right? Idea is to kind of rotate people in and out. So if there's a specific question that comes and let's say, you know, you're not satisfied with the answer given, maybe you want something to contribute, so you would come up and take the chair and contribute, right? So it would hopefully be more inclusive and more involving rather than just the seed group that we start with. Okay? So I'm going to invite maybe four people to get started with and then encourage other people to kind of come up and kind of take the stage as and when we go. So that's the hard part of picking. All right, LP. Come up. I'm zoning out on names, sorry. Brian? Martin? This is going to be totally on the fly, nothing prepared. So you guys will help. I'm going to try and kickstart with the first question, and then I'm going to get off, and then other people can take questions, and then we're going to turn it into more of a self-organizing thing. So the first question I had for the panel is that, you know, we've heard a lot about functional programming and the need for functional programming, where it's coming from, and one of the main driving factors, if I understand, is concurrency. Concurrency is one of the main driving factors pushing the envelope for functional programming. And I can think of a bunch of other examples or a bunch of other factors that are pushing for functional programming. But what in your experience are kind of the core factors that are driving the adoption of functional programming?
Increasing cheapness of multiprocessor computers. So even now on an embedded device, you have a hard time buying a system that has just one processor in it. And most of our programming languages were designed in an era where multiprocessor systems were unheard of, or multiprocessor systems were high-performance computing. So you would have things like OpenMP. And if you've never done OpenMP, it is a fantastic nightmare from another world, which is not generally applicable without extensive training. And even with extensive training, it's very difficult to get right, because it's optimized for systems where memory is resident, not necessarily on the same board as a processor, so that multiple processors can share them in a sort of interesting topology, which just doesn't exist now. So, you know, we have a need for languages that expose constructs and make it simple to reason about concurrent programs. And it just so happens that a lot of research into doing that was done in the context of functional programming. And functional programming makes certain constructions of concurrent programs much more simple. Erlang, for instance, doesn't allow you to fiddle with memory across process boundaries. So that's one area where a language like Go falls down compared to Erlang, because Go, if you are disciplined, allows you to write concurrent programs that don't have spooky action or distance effects, but you are allowed to fiddle with memory. And often you are encouraged by the nature of the language to fiddle with memory for performance reasons. Whereas in Erlang, you're just totally shut down. In Haskell, you are totally shut down. You can't do that. And that is hugely valuable. In Rust, you can't do that without either explicitly copying or mutating some data that you now have exclusive control of. So functional languages are hugely valuable because they restrict you in ways that are beneficial on dangerous computers.
aside from the things that are sort of talked about a lot, which is concurrency, which is fault tolerance has been brought up a lot today as well. I think one of the things that sort of sells functional languages to people when you're first showing it to them is how much you can do with how little code. So, you know, I don't know how many of you have seen Erlang the movie, but it sort of starts with Joe Armstrong showing he's an imperative program, and it's 150 lines, and he's the same program in Erlang, and it's sort of 10 or 15 lines. And the ability to do more with less and to have a more expressive language that doesn't churn out just reams and reams of code for the sake of churning out reams and reams of code, I think is actually, it's a really big selling point. It's not necessarily unique to functional languages. Python and stuff have similar kinds of higher level constructs that allow you to do it, but certainly it seems a far more intrinsic aspect of functional languages to be able to do a lot with very little. And the big data, fast data talk we just had an excellent example of this, where it was doing a lot of complex processing on a stream with just a few relatively simple lines of code all sort of chained together. And I mean, developers, as a developer, I think you should hate to write code. You should try to write as little code as possible. And the less code you can express yourself in, the better, because it becomes easier to maintain, it becomes easier for other people to get on board with and understand. And I think that's something that kind of just falls out naturally from functional programming. And that for me is a really big selling point for it.
So I think we had constraints which kind of help you. Then you talked about expressiveness and we talked about concurrency.
Yeah. I mean, I think definitely concurrency is the big driver. If you take a step back, I guess that's because Moore's law started to fail us, right? They couldn't make single cores any faster without overheating. And of course, there's the availability of big data, which is also accelerating at rocket speed. I think from my perspective, an important thing is also that we want to bring domain experts to bear on the programming tasks as well. And if computer science and software engineers have trouble with locking locks and semaphores, you can be sure that people who started out as electrical engineers or actuaries are really going to struggle. I think that's actually becoming an important driver. An ironic thing that I sort of felt like asking at the end of Nilanian's talk a moment ago, I hope I pronounced that right. Nilanjan, thank you. I'll try to get that right next time. It's a bit ironic that we need smart kids to help make a few people rich and the rest of us dumb. When Google suggests to me that I only look at news items that are similar to ones I've already seen, it makes my blood boil. Maybe I'm just an old man.
I think another selling point for functional programming in the case of concurrency, he talked about copying data around and that having immutable data helps to distribute work. Another thing is pure functions. Pure functions, which are functions without side effect, are much easier to distribute across the cluster, across the node, across process, since they don't have any side effects. And I think that's something that in the imperative world that you don't really get normally.
Okay, cool. Anyone else wants to add anything else based on their experience? I think we had a few perspectives over here. I'm sure there are a lot more experiences people have why they would choose functional languages. This is supposed to be interactive, not like boom, cool. Cricket, yes, that could get everyone speaking.
I mean, it's related to, or another comment related to what I said about domain experts is that functional programming is simpler, it's closer to maths. So it's easier to reason about, quite simply.
easier to reason about. I think it's more inclusive to get other people from other walks of life to kind of come in and start contributing, get the real domain experts to actually try and program stuff out. Yeah. All right, so let's move on to the next question, which is essentially, I mean, I think Nilanjan and I were having this discussion last night about code is liability, and you should have as little code as possible. You know, at least when I was kind of back in the days when, you know, much younger, much more immature, I think what I believed was code is everything. I mean, clean code, writing that is the be-all, end-all of what the programmer should do. And these days, I kind of believe that code is really liability. And, you know, kind of taking one step further, the languages itself is not that important. But yet we have all these religious war about, you know, Clojure versus Haskell versus Erlang versus this. So the question to the panel here is, how much does the language really matter? And should we really care about it? Or is it just a tool to get the job done?
So my feeling with languages is that it is a tool, but it's any other tradesman has a box full of tools for all sorts of different jobs. You don't use a screwdriver, a hammer, and a nail. And just like languages, no one language is your tool to do everything. So the choice of language is important in as far as that you need to choose the right tool to do the right job. I mean, it's, you know, it sounds like a cliche, but the number of people who think that C++ or Java is the tool to do every job ever. You know, when all you've got in your toolbox is a hammer, well, everything starts to look like a nail, even that really fragile thing over there that will break when I hit it with C++. The choice of language is, to my mind, definitely important. It's not the only thing. You can obviously do multiple things with multiple languages, but it's, I think, incumbent on people making the choice of language to be aware of the different languages that are out there and what their strengths and weaknesses are, so that they can make an informed choice of what tool to pull out of their box for this problem.
Okay, so you're kind of hinting that look at languages more as a tool and pick the language based on the right tool for the right job. Okay.
Yeah, I think to add on to that, all languages implicitly solve some problem for their creator. You know, the very few people, I think, go out and they just make a language that's production quality and ready for thousands of people to use just for giggles. I don't think it's something that you do. So that implies that there is a particular problem or class of problems that the language is meant to resolve. So Erlang, for instance, solves a certain type of soft real-time networked system problem where you need it to stay on all the time and whatnot, and C++, despite how you've been burned by it, is intended to solve the problem where you need access to the hardware of the machine and to fiddle with memory in really unsafe ways because you're able to reason, whether rightly or not, that fiddling with the memory like that is the correct thing to do.
I love C++. It's just, I don't want to write a telephone system in it again, that's all.
Oh yeah, no, absolutely not. And it's insane to do that. Yeah. And it's insane to do that because not every part of a telephone system needs hardware fiddling. And if you look at a company like Mozilla, who is writing Rust to solve the problem of building high-performance, general-purpose applications, they've said that, okay, we need all of the features of modern C++ minus the unsafe memory fiddling. And what does that look like? So, you know, when you choose a language functional imperative, you are implicitly saying that my problem is similar-ish to the problem that this language originally solved. Because a language, if you strip away the syntax, you're just left with the golden core of semantics. And the semantics of languages are radically different. The semantic properties of Haskell with its lazy evaluation are radically different from, say, the semantic properties of Rust, where it's very eager and you can't fiddle with memory. And I think you get into trouble when you say that there is a general purpose language whose semantic model is similar enough to all possible problem domains. It's true, they're general purpose languages, they're Turing complete, you can cram it in anywhere, but it's a real hard time. And then on top of that, you have the implementations of languages. So you have a language that has a virtual machine. Now that virtual machine has to fit into the problem domain that you need. So I work primarily in Erlang and C++. And I only do C++ when I can't fit a virtual machine onto the computer that I'm trying to program, which is a real shame because I would love to not have to deal with fiddling with memory, and Rust is not ready yet for any of that.
I agree with you both. There's one thing I think you guys are kind of forgetting is like the business side of thing. Often you have business constraints, so you only have one programmer that knows like PHP or some other language, and your website, yes, has a chat system that's real time, but there's five users, so do you really need Erlang to build that? So probably not. There's a huge, well, you should, maybe, but like the learning curve is high. If the guy can get the job done in 5 days using PHP, even though it's a hammer and he needs a screwdriver, then so be it. Like there, you have to balance, like you don't always have to build like a cathedral. You can build a shack if it does the job for a little bit, and then eventually if there's more traffic and you need to start scaling, think of re-architecting and using some other language that's more appropriate.
Point well made.
Not much more to add at this point. yeah, I mean, obviously you have business constraints, and those can both be of the form that, you know, you thou shalt use the Java VM. It can also be that you know you're, you know, coming in as a consultant working for some people, and they're going to have to maintain it afterwards. But I think it's really important to be aware of other programming paradigms. You can do object-oriented or functional programming in any language. Though, of course, you have to make sure somebody, whoever has to maintain it, is able to do that when you've been and gone. So maybe I can ask you a question. You said Erlang and C++. Mm-hmm. Is your C++ influenced by Erlang?
Massively, yes.
I thought so. Right.
So I guess the point you're kind of trying to make there, or hint, or that's what I'm interpreting, is that languages kind of bend you. They kind of influence you in a particular direction. They open, they kind of broaden your perspective in certain ways that earlier you probably thought was not possible. But then when you start exploring a different language, it's like, wow, okay, you know, this interesting concept or idiom in that language that, yep, you know, suddenly starts influencing how you would write code in another language. So learning languages, I think, is important, but, you know, how important is arguing about a particular language?
Oh, I wouldn't do that. I would, you know, read books like Bruce Tate's 7 Languages in 7 Weeks and try to immerse yourself a bit and stop arguing and try and extract knowledge is what I would say.
Yeah.
I think some of the sort of holy wars thing that we have is not really predicated on a serious technical distinction. It's predicated more on fear. You know, you spend years becoming an expert at a certain language or technology, and if you choose wrong, you're out of luck. You know, I don't think I would be employable if suddenly C++ and Erlang both went out of style. If nobody wanted to use them anywhere, I would, I don't know, I guess be a farmer, you know? So if I were of a certain personality and I had a certain fear of my particular technologies that I've chosen to become an expert at, if I had a fear of them disappearing, I might engage in holy wars because I might want to dissuade people from using super Erlang instead of normal Erlang. Or oh, it's called Elixir, yeah. Yeah, Elixir is a fun example. It's a language that targets the Erlang VM and it keeps the same semantic model. So it adds some syntactical goodies, but it doesn't really fundamentally change how you go about doing computation on the Erlang virtual machine, called the Beam for historical reasons. Whereas a language like Clojure does change the semantic model. So it's difficult for a Java programmer and a Clojure programmer to communicate, whereas it's relatively easy for an Elixir programmer and an Erlang programmer to communicate.
It's actually interesting you bring up this point because last year's conference, one of the keynotes by Bruce Tate was about fear and how fear is used as a way to influence a language adoption. It was kind of an interesting keynote around, you know, some of the driving factors, which I was hoping would come up, which you kind of brought up. It's like fear is actually a pretty big factor in terms of language choice.
Right.
Joe Armstrong, in a talk at an Erlang miniconf I was at a couple of years ago, talked about the sort of path that Erlang had followed through its life in Ericsson. And at one point, having developed this really great, well, obviously I'm biased here, but great language, and started using it quite effectively within the company, new management came through and no Erlang, no more Erlang, banned, done, you're all out. And apparently one of the primary arguments there was, well, I can go out tomorrow and hire 1,000 Java programmers. Where am I going to get 1,000 Erlang programmers from? And of course, Joe's answer quite reasonably was, well, yes, but you won't need 1,000 Erlang programmers. And what you're going to have tomorrow then is 1,000 Java programmers. And then what are you going to do? But you're right that at a management level, there is definitely this fear of adopting new things as well. It's where we use Java because everyone else uses Java. We use C++ because that's the standard choice for this stuff. And to which, you know, my response often is, well, yes, you're choosing it because all your competitors have chosen it, and now you're following your competitors, and that's how you're planning to get ahead of them.
That's a good point. Okay. All right, we'll open up the floor for other people to ask questions so that I don't bore you guys.
You can also please come up as well.
Yeah. Anyone wants to ask a question? Mayank.
I think there is a second side of it is that instead of focusing on the concepts, we tell them to learn languages, that this language will solve your problem. But actually, what you really want them to learn is the concept, and not just the languages concept, but also like networking and distributed systems and fault tolerance, which may be baked into the language, like for example, Erlang. But even if you do use, say, PHP or whatever, you can still have those guarantees if you really understand the concepts. So I just want to like discuss that.
Sorry, is there a question in there?
It's more of a discussion on this because I keep hearing like, learn this language and learn this language, Haskell, learn Erlang, or learn Clojure, but nobody talks about go learn, you know, operating systems properly, go learn networking properly. Like the focus is completely, I think, is in the wrong direction.
No, I agree. I think learning the concept is far more important, and once you have those underlying concepts, moving from one language to another becomes a lot easier. Because you're not being forced to, you're not being forced to do stuff language X's way. You just need to learn how to apply the concepts that you already know in language X, and that makes learning the language itself a lot less stressful. I think anyone who's saying you need to learn language X, you need to learn language Y is probably, yeah, I think you're right. It's probably taking the wrong approach. It's what's not necessarily the wrong approach is saying, you should probably look at learning language X because it provides a good introduction to these concepts, and then maybe go and look at how they're, so, you know, Erlang provides an excellent introduction to highly concurrent fault-tolerant systems. Yes, you can absolutely go and do that in Haskell or a number of other languages. C++ provide excellent introductions into the really low-level guts of stuff, fiddling around with memory pointers, what sockets really look like at a sort of raw level. These are all extremely useful concepts to have when you go and start using that stuff at a higher level. So yeah, absolutely. I think there are languages that are good for learning these things, and it's good to learn those languages. But I don't think a language should be learned necessarily for its own sake. Once you want to go and become an expert in that language, once you've decided that's, you know, the path you're going to follow, absolutely learn that language as much as you can. But don't just learn a language because it's on a checklist or because someone's told you it's the language of the future. Because that's what somebody told me about Ruby about 15 years ago, so.
Also, I mean, move beyond the syntax, right? I mean,
yeah,
go deeper.
The syntax is just the means to an end there.
I actually don't necessarily think learning languages, starting with languages is a bad idea. You can go for it. I mean, that's how I started with Scala. But you'll see some of these programming languages find a sweet spot, like Erlang has a distributed concurrent application. Scala also getting there with Akka. So the way I transitioned to distributed that I had to learn, right? I want to work with Scala. I ended up finding jobs which require me to learn distributed computing. So I had to pick up. So it's also a matter of interest, I mean. And that's why also it's very critical, I think, that like Naresh pointed out already, and it was a previous question, I wanted to come up. I I didn't. Maybe I should have. Is that languages?
You can't go back in time.
We cannot go back. So okay, I will end here.
No, go ahead, Cherry.
Yeah, I think a great analogy is if you're trying to learn a culture's sense of humor. One of my favorite German television shows is about and it's a comedy. It's about a crime scene cleaner. There are no jokes. He goes to crimes, and then he cleans them up, and then he leaves. And that is the entire joke. Now, to internalize the German sense of humor, you have to learn the German language, and you have to read a lot of German literature. So it is difficult to separate the German sense of humor from the ambiguity of the German language. It is difficult to separate the German sense of despair as comedy from the German language itself. And it's difficult in programming languages to separate, say, the sort of network style of computation that Erlang has internalized so deeply from Erlang itself. And it's difficult to take something like C++, where you have all of these concepts, and then also learn the network style of computation, because you're doing so much at one time. So that's why, you know, people will say, you know, if you want to learn reasoning about pure functional programming, that Haskell, which has internalized that concept, is the language that you should probably use. Increasingly, I hear in the Bay Area, if you want to learn about how to write memory-safe programs, don't do modern C++, write in Rust, and then port that knowledge to C++, because, God help you, the GCC won't. But that you're able to internalize these concepts without having to deal with a whole lot of extra context.
I think it really depends also on your personality. Learning, when you just learn concepts, sometimes it's hard to understand them, and applying them to learn those concepts is, at least for me, really useful. So finding some problem you want to solve, and then trying to figure out a tool to solve it, and if by doing so you learn a new language, then it's great. I think one problem that comes up often for us for hiring is that we try to hire a lot of computer scientists, but coming out of computer science, usually you only learn about concepts. You don't write that much code, at least that's how it is in our area. And then you try to make them write production code, and they're incapable. They don't know how to apply those concepts into real code and how to glue all this stuff together. In theory, like, they can write pseudocode and it looks good on paper, but then writing the actual code does not come out properly. So I think for that reason, actually learning a language is good, but you shouldn't follow trends of new languages coming out, like on Hacker News every week. Oh, this is a new cool distributed language built on top of this VM that compiles this JavaScript and runs on the browser. And another point is also for hiring. I was saying often computer scientists don't really, they're not that useful coming out of school just because they don't have any experience. So for us, for hiring, we hire Erlang people, and there's like 5 Erlang programmers in Quebec. So yeah, being generous. So you can't just go on LinkedIn and look up like people to hire. So you have to look up for people that have a passion or excitement for functional programming. So they have experience in Haskell, or they built some scheme variant, or like they worked in functional programming, and you know they'll have an interest and they already know some of the concepts. So then they can translate this knowledge into a new language, and they'll be proactive and be able to write production code more quickly.
So, I mean, I would say learning a language is actually a good way, because I was doing Python and VB and all that early in my career, and the only reason I picked up a scheme was because Eric Raymond told about it in his book, and he said that, okay, you learn Python, and or if you have pick a practical language like Python or Perl, and just learn Lisp for its internal beauty. So I picked up scheme, learned a lot of stuff about, you know, hygienic macros and all that kind of stuff, and then learned Common Lisp after that, the Art of Meta Object Protocol and that stuff like that. I mean, had I not just started blindly learning the language, I wouldn't have been introduced to those concepts at all in the first place. Right? I mean, I think it's a good idea to just pick up a language, and I mean, it may not be relevant for your current job, but you know, knowledge never hurt anybody.
The distinction, though, is you individually going and picking up versus someone forcing you to learn a particular language, right?
So yeah, I mean, after I became a convert, I did that.
This you process. Started doing that on the people you manage. Hey, wonderful.
Dude,
all right, what other questions people have? All right, we'll go there and then, okay, Mayank, go ahead.
So given a language, what are the three things that you will look into it to understand how good or bad a certain language is? Because we keep having new languages every day. I don't know if I should, how do I analyze it and realize that, okay, this is a good language, or what is a good language?
Given a language, what are the three attributes you would look for in the language? Pass the mic to someone else.
You're right. There are a metric shit ton of new languages that come out every year, and most of them probably aren't worth your time. Why is that? You know, when I evaluate a new language, what I am interested in is how applicable is it to real-time systems? How well can I push bytes across a network? And how well can I transform text? Primarily because I work on things that have some sort of disastrous consequence. They have implicit clocks, they're real-time systems, and I like writing compilers. I do that for giggles, though. So when I evaluate a language, I ask of that language, you know, what's your real-time story? What's your story with regard to resource consumption? Can I reason about how you're consuming resources in terms of, say, computation time or total CPU time or memory time? I write compilers in Haskell, and I really enjoy it. But Haskell is a language that I would be concerned about deploying into things that I get paid to do because I have a hard time reasoning about its space usage. You know, you can sort of sprinkle strictness things through it so you can force it to do computations, but there's no way of automatically saying that, you know, this resource, this memory consumption will only be so much. It's why I favor languages that don't have garbage collectors, because usually I need to know that, you know, I have only allocated 40 megabytes and I will only ever use no more than 40 megabytes. But that's just me applying my particular interest, my particular niche, over and over again to a language. To me, JavaScript seems like garbage, but, you know, I don't do anything that JavaScript is good at. So that's my implicit needs being pushed off onto the world, and then I just get harsh about it.
I actually think there's kind of two categories. First of all, there's some programming language are basically just tool to learn new concept. They might just be kind of coming out of papers or more like research oriented. Those you probably shouldn't learn just for career move, but to learn for new concept and explore, open your mind to new concept, programming concept. The second type of programming language, I would say, the ones that you want to learn to actually get a job and become an expert, then I think one of the things that you didn't mention is the community around it. To pick the language, you need to be, there needs to be libraries available, there needs to be an ecosystem around like the virtual machine. It has to be kind of on GitHub, and you need to be able to contribute and evolve the language to make sure there's a future also for that language. So when you're picking your language, for instance, if you picked Erlang, like for me, you're on the mailing list, you're on GitHub checking the issues, like it becomes part of kind of your life. So you need to be able to pick a language where you can see yourself, be passionate about it, and be happy working with it every day.
So, I mean, I didn't have quite some logic to taking language. For example, Elm. I came here, I looked at Elm when in one of these talks in Functional Conference, it's like, man, that looks very pretty, I gotta learn that, right? I mean, there's no other reason why I choose languages, except that now I understand how signals work, how this thing works. There are a lot of these frameworks that are coming in, like Redux and BubOp and all these frameworks coming in JavaScript, which are porting a lot of those ideas back into mainstream languages. So, I mean, it doesn't hurt, really. I mean, I think you should evaluate. I mean, there is a question of time and how much time you can spend to do it. But if it catches your fancy, then Why not?
I mean, the problem, I think, is also sometimes to actually really understand the language, you need to spend a decent amount of time.
That's true. That's true.
Otherwise, you might discard a language which might actually be a really good language, right? So
yeah,
it is about that balance that you were talking about.
Yes, that is correct. So, I mean, there have been languages that I've been wanting to try out, like Elixir. I have been meaning to try that out, but for some reason, I haven't gotten a problem to solve that I could use the Elixir in, right? I mean, and so I've never tried it. Or it hasn't caught my fancy yet. I mean, I think it's different from person to person, like you said. I mean,
there's no problems for Elixir.
Yeah.
The one other criteria I'd say, and it sounds kind of silly, but you kind of want the language to be a bit fun to use, because if you're not having fun when you're learning it and when you're playing around with it, you're not going to take as much of an interest in it and you're not going to want to spend as much time with it. So, I mean, it's not a good technical basis for choosing a language, but it's a good basis for choosing a language that you might want to spend a bit of time with and a bit more time getting to know. And I know for me that was definitely the case with Erlang. I'd sort of played with a number of functional languages before, mostly at university, and none of them they'd always just kind of for me been painful to use. And I picked up Erlang, and suddenly here was a functional language that wasn't painful to use, that I could just jump in and start doing stuff with, and that sort of grabbed my attention and gave me the enthusiasm to keep going with it and keep learning it. So. Yeah, as I say, not a good technical basis, but I think it's probably worth throwing into the mix.
One interesting thing happened when I picked a functional programming, the concept itself, the paradigm itself, is that I actually became a better O programmer. I don't know whether it makes sense or not, but it actually happened. So one criteria that I use, I don't know how effective is that, probably non-technical completely, is that I once I learn one particular functional language, I'm probably not going to learn another functional language. Usually I don't. So one interesting criteria could be to try to learn different programming paradigms. It's probably the hardest thing to do, but it actually the one that will make you think differently, which is probably the most important value to have, right? Thinking differently. So maybe functional programming, I don't know what beyond, maybe logic programming, pick up a logic programming language. That could be an interesting way to look at it.
Cool. I think we had a question over there.
The question is related to the industry adoption of functional programming. Is it considered as a de facto standard for writing web services right now? And like what rate this adoption is happening? Is it a hopeful scenario down there? As a professional, like how this is being looked at in the industry as a functional programmer versus a C++ programmer or a Java programmer?
I didn't quite catch all of that.
What's the adoption of functional programming in industry?
Of functional programming in industry, how does it compare with, you know, other languages? So, yeah. Around DevOps, but we'll come to that a little later.
Yeah, I think the total adoption, if you look at the entire range of software development, is minuscule. But it's sort of a difficult question, because you're really saying, like, well, what's the adoption rate of Java? And if you look at a certain segment of industry like banking, relatively low, on the rise, but still relatively low. So you sort of have to say, like, what's the problem domain? And what problem domain are you interested in working in? So, for instance, if I were interested in working in web development, I would have real problems, because the adoption of functional programming language there is just like bleeding edge. But I very much enjoy working on these sort of like big embedded real-time systems, and functional programming does incredibly well there. So it's kind of a non-answer, unfortunately, but minuscule if you take the entire swath of software development, but if you take certain niches, very high.
And just to add to that a little bit, I know Haskell is used surprisingly extensively in things like high-speed trading and finance and so forth. Talking to Francesco, who runs Erlang Solutions, he said a number of large companies that make use of his services actually make him sign an NDA because they consider using Erlang a competitive advantage, and they don't want their competitors to know that they're using it. So, and you know, take that with a grain of salt, because obviously he makes his money selling Erlang services, but I wouldn't be at all surprised if that's the case. And so that's the kind of thing that makes it even perhaps more difficult to quantify, because you don't necessarily, you know, there's not a census that goes out every couple of years saying what languages do you use in your industry and stuff. So I get the impression that you'd probably be surprised by how many places it actually is used, albeit not necessarily for the large products, but maybe around the periphery of some places, of some things as well.
Yeah, I think in numbers of actual people working in functional programming, it's really, really low. But those people, the work they do touches a lot of people. So there was a quote, I think, at Erlang factory 2 years ago, something like 50% of text messages will go through a switch that runs Erlang. And then, like, on Facebook, for anti-spam, it uses Askel. Or there's a lot of stuff in the background that no one knows it's running functional on a functional program, but it is, in fact. But it's like two guys writing something that can see a million requests a second. That's the kind of the difference, instead of having 100 Java programmers just working on a problem factory.
One of the greatest validation that functional programming in RISE is Java 8. Java 8 being adding Lambda after a decade, it's a huge indicator that functional programming is here to stay. I mean, people were going to be eventually forced to kind of pick it up and learn.
The counter argument to that is people still write procedural code in Java, so people still write Fortran in Java, if that sounds better. Right? So, but you're right. I mean,
can't help everybody, you know.
But you're right. I mean, if you look across the industry, the adoption of functional concepts in mainstream languages is on a rise, right? So that's a good indicator. Cool. Few questions. So I think this gentleman is waiting, then I'll come to you. And then there, and then here. Okay. Whoever gets the mic, I guess. So you got okay. The mic, go for it.
Okay. So you just talked about that the management is pushing that whenever you can do a task like 10 Erlang programmers, but you management still wants to give 1,000 Java developers because they're easy to find. So I'm coming from the other side where management is telling me that when I can have only 10 people working for me, why do I hire 1,000 Java programmers? And they want us to revisit all our applications and see if we can fit them in the functional paradigm. And so is it really possible? Does all application fit in the functional paradigm? Or how can we go about solving this problem?
I think it strongly depends on the application. There are some things that are very, very focused on, say, business rules that are inherently messy, and you'll never really reduce the amount of manpower that you need to make something like that. Primarily because they're political artifacts rather than technical artifacts, which is fine. You know, we need political artifacts. We're a tribal species. But you can look at some things and you can sort of say, you know, you have, say, a large C++ system that happens to be arranged internally such that there are threads that then pass around these tiny little structs that happens to represent work. If you happen to know that that's how the Erlang virtual machine is implemented, perhaps you can just redo it in Erlang, depending on the constraints of the system. So I have, in the past, done consulting for that very thing. And you can definitely find people whose job it is to go around and analyze systems and say, you know, this language is applicable, this language is applicable, this one is applicable to that problem, then give estimates on how long it would take to change them. Usually, though, rewriting is a real challenge, because there are a whole lot of things that are mysteriously wrong that people come to depend on, which you will then fix or adapt. But wrapping a legacy system in a functional system is a real good approach, and you can sort of squeeze it until it's gone.
I was gonna say, also it depends kind of the size of the application you're rewriting. If it's a million lines, like you're probably doing a mistake. You probably shouldn't rewrite everything. The hybrid approach is probably something smarter, especially when there's business rules involved. Unless you have the most amazing test suite in the industry, you're for sure introducing new bugs and unforeseen. Also, deadlines are never met. when you rewrite at first, you're like, yeah, it's going to work, and then you're 6 months late and not even close to having something working because some of the assumptions made and then the previous programs were just completely broken, or the specs were not defined properly. So there's undefined behaviors that you have to kind of reverse engineer to figure out how it works. But if it's starting a new project and it fits the paradigm, then you should always go, you should try to go for functional programming. You'll need to hire less people. So if your job is managing people, then if you're managing 10 instead of 1,000, your job is much easier.
If you're doing rewrite, probably you shouldn't. We have really horror stories about rewrite. We should talk before you do that. But I think there is another interesting aspect to this, though, right? The cost associated with it. I mean, what type of problem? I mean, there is a cost of type system or rewriting or reasoning about co-writing functional code. If your application is just taking an HTTP request or returning JSON, I don't know whether there is a value of FP there.
The other question, I guess, in terms of a rewrite is what do you actually get by rewriting it? Is it a more or less stable application and someone's just said, you know what, we should do stuff with functional languages now, then that's not in and of itself a reason to rewrite something. If you're adding a huge amount of functionality or you want to change something major in it or something, sure, look at rewriting it, look at maybe just adding that new bit in a functional language. Our telco system that I work on, by functional points, I guess, roughly about half of it is still the old C++ stuff because we've got a small team and there is no point, no significant value at the moment in rewriting the old stuff because it still works. And the amount of maintenance we do in it is fairly minimal because it's kind of in a more or less steady state. All the new stuff we're adding is in Erlang, and so we're getting all the nice benefits from that. But rewriting for the sake of rewriting is rarely as good an idea as the engineers often feel it is. And I've been there myself. I'm like, man, we should totally rewrite that. But no, it's not always the greatest idea. The question really is why do you want to rewrite it? What value are you getting out of it? Or has it just become like totally unmaintainable? Is it a massive morass of code that no one understands anymore? Does it not perform well enough? If there's value there in rewriting it, then certainly, you know, look at it that way. But in addition to the questions that these guys have suggested, it's obviously important to ask why you would rewrite it in the first place.
Okay.
Yeah.
Who's got the mic? Yeah.
Yeah. The extent of type safety in function programming languages, like we have dynamic function programming languages like the Erlang and Clojure on the other side, and we have Scala and Haskell. How does the type safety does really matter in function programming?
It's must, mandatory to have set of types.
Okay, we have this monads and all that in Haskell, and we have the functional programming, which is like dynamic in Clojure. Like, how does it really get along?
So I do a fair amount of work in a language that has a strong set type system, Haskell, and a fair amount of work for money in a language that has basically no type system, which is Erlang. Everything is just a term, and then you match on terms. You say it's not fair, but I think it's true.
It's strongly typed. It's just dynamically typed.
Okay, but that's fair.
Change around you all the time.
That's very true. So to answer your question, I think there are certain classes of problems that having a static type system is hugely valuable for, because you're able to say that, this problem that I'm solving is largely algorithmic. It can be modeled mathematically, and I can then express that in a certain type of logic. I'm blanking on the name. First class preparatory logic, I think, is what Haskell ships with. So if you can encode your problem in that certain type of logic, then it's great. You can also squeeze things that don't necessarily fit into that. So for instance, if you are working in a language where you're very, very concerned, or working in a problem domain where you're very, very concerned about memory consumption, that's not really something that gets modeled in any of the mainstream functional programming languages. Even the ones that have dependent typing, they don't give you insight into the compiler's memory use or the language's underlying memory use. So at that point, if you need to solve for hard memory constraints, you kind of need to abandon either the type system, either sort of the type system, because you need a language that gives you those certain guarantees. But problems where you're transforming structures all the time, or where you are going to fiddle around a lot, and with a certain data structure, in a way that is difficult to model, a type system is a very useful thing there. If you are doing, say, sort of unconstrained message passing, something that has a static type system is not super valuable because you don't necessarily know where a message will come from. The research project Cloud Haskell is trying to address that, but progress has been very, very slow, in part because I don't think we've invented the math for it.
Actually, we should talk about this because in ECHA we are adding session types to kind of address some of this. So one thing I want to add, I'm sorry about that thing about, I'm going to agree with him in saying there is a cost associated with the reason I say how much money you want to pay for the correctness, right? Type system is going to give you that. It's probably going to slow you down initially. But there's this concept that evolving now, and there was in a Haskell presentation that guy also mentioned about type-driven development. It's not test-driven, it's a different kind of development where your types are guiding through, it's just helping you to think about the problem. There's a tremendous value in that.
I work primarily with Erlang, which is not typed, but there is an optional type system where you can write specs and run dialyzer, which will do type analysis for you. And I think if you're doing kind of any Erlang code in production and you're not using that tool, you're not shooting yourself in the foot, but basically like you're leaving out a good tool to make sure there's no bugs. I think type systems are quite useful, just because for one, you know exactly what the interface of your function expects. In Erlang, yes, there is compile time kind of types where you know you're expecting a tuple or a list, but then what's in the list? So what kind of data can I send to this function and receive something that's meaningful for me after? So in Erlang, to solve this problem, there's this optional type system that they added. They would have made it mandatory, but it would have broken all the code before. So basically, this was the kind of way to implement it without breaking all the code that existed.
on that note, the one thing we did find with having a dynamically typed language like Erlang is that the iterative development process, I think, goes, and you kind of touched on this, it goes a lot faster. If you're ripping out bits, adding parameters, taking parameters away, changing parameters, you can do that a lot faster when you're not having to explicitly describe the types all the way through. And I think Erlang in particular provides a very good balance with this, in that once you've sort of got stuff working, and once all your functions and stuff are bedded down a little bit, you can then go back and add the type data to them, the explicit type data, and even without the explicit type data, Dialyzer is a very useful tool, and it will allow you to do a lot of the static checking that you get in a strictly typed language like Haskell, without the sort of development overhead of constantly having to have those types there. That was pretty much all I had.
I think one of the arguments in favor of type systems is, you know, it kind of helps communicate to other developers looking at that code. So there's an element about communication. But I also think it kind of depends on the kind of problem that you're trying to solve, because certain kinds of problem domains, right, what the type is actually is irrelevant. Especially if you like take example of web development, most often, you know, it's just strings and you just treat everything as string, doesn't really matter. So putting a type system over there might help you with communication, but will slow you down and will add unnecessary complexity as a programmer you have to deal with. So I guess that might be one of the criteria to think about.
One other thing I find it a little struggling in statically typed, I'm against of statically typed system, and one bit, that is if I want to experiment an idea, let's have a large code base, experiment an idea, I want to take a thin slice of the flow and just change something and immediately get the feedback, that becomes harder. I know Haskell has an option which Scala gets that where you can disable the type check for a second. Just say, just compile it for me. I just want to see what happens. That is an interesting experience that I miss, that dynamically languages has that feature.
Yeah, even the type inference helps a lot in Scala, whatever we have. That helps a lot and makes the field to be a dynamic language, but still it's static.
Only if you can go beyond the 3 hours of debugging the compiler errors and shit like that. It's like, ooh.
You do it.
No, I've seen other people do it. I've not ventured into it.
Just if I can add to the previous question, could you guys talk a little bit about how you would compare personally Erlang versus Haskell? Feel free to make unqualified opinionated statements. But just from a programming point of view, personal programming point of view, what do you specifically like and dislike? At the risk of starting a war, it's okay. You can go for it.
So comparing Erlang and Haskell, I use Haskell when I need to transform something within a single machine. So I take an input to a black box and then I push it out of that black box, and I need it to be of a certain quality of correctness. I need to be relatively certain that this black box that I'm pushing stuff into will push the correct notion out. But this is all resident on the same machine, or if I need it to be very fast in terms of CPU, and I've got a lot of RAM available. So when I program in Haskell, I am thinking about transformation of structures, and I am thinking about an arbitrary machine where I've got effectively unlimited resources. When I program in Erlang, however, I am implicitly thinking about groups of machines that are coordinating over a lossy, unreliable network. Usually the machines are resource constricted in some way, and even though Erlang doesn't really expose at a language level the resource consumption in terms of memory and in terms of CPU, it's all documented. So I happen to know how much a single process costs. I happen to know how much a single tuple costs. And while you can find that in, say, GHC, it changes from version to version because it's not something that's pegged in the language or the implementation itself. So it's kind of a difference between, you know, GHC Haskell is a research language, and it's intended for software that needs to be correct. And the software implicitly has a very short service lifetime, meaning that you run it, it runs very quickly, and then it stops. Whereas Erlang is always been a production-oriented system, meaning that its operational semantics are well understood, and its service lifetime is very, very long. So you turn it on, and then you don't shut it off for decades, or with a couple of modifications to the language until the heat death of the universe. So the design of the language and the tooling that you're given are different, because you need to be able to, in 30 years, interact with a running machine. Whereas in Haskell, of course, you've just got this binary blob that's just churning along and it runs for about 2.5 seconds. So the difference in focus changes how the tooling works, changes how the languages work, and it changes how people approach building things in either language. So that has an effect. So service lifetimes, resource consumption, those are the two things that I think of as different, substantially different between Erlang and Haskell, you know, ignoring the type system and all of that, because that's just fancy dressing on top of those two core concerns.
So I think, Tanmay, you've deployed something into production in Haskell, right? So what was your criteria for choosing Haskell and like?
Correctness. So we needed correct software, and we needed to make it really quickly. So, and we need to push things into production really, really fast. I mean, in the sense of I would make a change, and then that change needs to be in production, and I need to make sure that it's correct, and I don't have time for exhaustive testing and analysis. I want to spend the time thinking about a feature, and then I want that feature to work, and I don't care about anything else. So from that kind of background, I think maybe Haskell was a very good fit for us. Especially we did not have real time or resource constraints like for what Erlang is useful. But yeah. So
the correctness and being sure when you actually push something, you know, having that high amount of certainty.
I mean, but I would like to emphasize not a mathematical amount of certainty, but a amount of certainty that I would expect from a good piece of software. Just that much certainty, which is much easier to approach in the way Haskell encourages you to think about things, I think, right? But I haven't really used Erlang well before, so.
Yeah, I think that's an interesting point. When you work in Haskell, you are implicitly very, very concerned about correctness. And when you work in Erlang, you are very, very concerned about fault tolerance. So you've accepted the fact that bad things will happen, and you can deal with them. And they will be controlled, and they will be restrained.
But a different nature of bad things, right? In Erlang, the kind of bad things that you're looking at are maybe perhaps at a systemic level. Whereas in Haskell, the kind of bad things that I want to protect myself against are at a software level. I don't want wrong output to go out. I don't want a data structure to come in where one key value pair is just ignored because I did not parse it into the right type. So aren't we talking about a different kind of errors, or is that question?
Sure. I think in both languages you get logic errors, right? Like the type system doesn't save you from transforming an abstract syntax tree incorrectly, so long as it type checks. In both Erlang and Haskell, you will get logic errors. But I often don't think about Erlang problems in terms of the cluster, because that's a radically different problem. I think about faults in terms of faults in an individual machine. So you get some input, it causes a code path that wasn't well tested to be triggered, which causes a fault, which causes a crash, and then gets restarted because of the supervisor. And you've just logged all of that. Like, all of that is now logged, and you can go back and inspect it. So really, it's pushing off correctness to a later date. So you might drop that single transaction, but you were implicitly working on a system in which if you service most of the traffic or the majority of the traffic, then it's fine. The system that I work on, it has around 10,000 errors per second, which sounds like a lot, except it's servicing, between 50 and 100 million things per second. So 10,000 is relatively small, and the amount of time that it would take us to write a Haskell system that was resource constrained and CPU constrained and also retrain everybody is radically more than it takes us to build the logging system that records a particular input, and then we just run a trace tool over the system to find out what code path went sideways. So really, it's do I need correctness right now, or do I need correctness eventually when something crazy happens?
Cool. Yeah, I think.
So the question was, how do you manage your management to do functional programming in production?
How you manage your management is the question.
Blackmail. aside from blackmail, I have been fairly lucky in my career in that I only work at places that are on board with using functional programming. So I live in the U.S. West Coast, so I am like a kid in a candy store, basically, and that there are a lot of new companies all the time, and they're really willing to do risky things. So I actually don't have great experience with bringing functional programming into a new organization, but in terms of sustaining one, that's sort of a different thing where, to the earlier question of, how many functional programmers are there really? If you look at my organization, there are around 120 software engineers. Most of them are Python, a little bit of Java. There are only 7 of us that are Erlangers. So, be generous and say 1/10 of the workforce is Erlangers. But we make the majority of the profits in the company. So it's sort of this ongoing story of, we don't have faults that bring the system down. We make a shitload of money for the company. And so the story to upper management is, even though it's really hard to find us, and even though it's very expensive to hire us, it's a clear value proposition. But as to how you get something into a company, that's going to have to be somewhere else.
So I guess I can talk about that a little bit, because we started with a C++ core manager and sort of managed to wheedle Erlang into it to the point that it's now what we develop all the new stuff in. I don't necessarily have a good general purpose answer for this, but I can talk sort of briefly about the process we went through, which was basically one of our developers discovered Erlang at a conference, decided it was the way of the future, and rather than sort of taking it straight to management saying, right, we need to write everything in this because that's never going to fly, we just started writing some little things in it that to sort of demonstrate it and also to convince ourselves that it was the right way to go. So we wrote
a load tester for our phone system that emulated, and it happily emulated like 1,000 phones on my laptop without sort of breaking a sweat. And then I took a day to distribute that across two machines, and suddenly we had this distributed load tester in this language. And demonstrating this sort of stuff by writing useful stuff that can simultaneously give value to the company and demonstrate the power of FP was sort of the way we got our foot in the door. Of course, you've also got to somehow sneak some time in to actually do this, because they probably won't let you do it on the clock as such. So luckily we had a sort of period of downtime where not much was going on, and we could work a couple of hours a day on this sort of thing. But once you've demonstrated some stuff, and then you can sort of go and present this stuff, talk a bit about what it is, why it's useful to the company and stuff. At the time, we were still a relatively flat management structure, so we only had sort of our immediate boss and the CTO to convince, and the CTO luckily was a guy who just code it, I don't care how you do it, which is rare, I would imagine, but we were lucky in that respect. And then, you know, by the time we got bought by Shortel, the functional part was such a big part and so sort of intrinsic to the whole thing that it wasn't even a question. Like no one has ever even suggested to us that we should take the Erlang part and no, just rewrite it in C++, because that's what the rest of the system is in, thankfully, because I think I'd have a conniption if they did.
For my part, at our company, we had to start a new project, and basically we were in a meeting room on trying to discuss which language we should pick. I think for this is to build a real-time bidding platform. This was like 5 years ago. And some suggested C, Node.js was just starting back then, and some were like, okay, Node.js would be a good fit. And then I suggested Erlang. And obviously, I was the only one that suggested Erlang at that point, but instead of picking the language in that meeting, we concluded that we'd take 2 months and build prototypes in each language. And Erlang just came out clear winner that, like, just by myself, I was able in like a week to build a simple bidder and talk to, one of the requirements was to talk to Cassandra, and the code was maintainable and testable, and it was much easier. In C, I didn't get very far, because just to get what you get starting with Erlang, you have to write 100,000 lines of code to be able to distribute, to be able to do SMP and all of that. It's really complicated. And then I won't even talk about Node.js. But so I think it's kind of a, you need to have a company that has a good culture to start off with, and like a CTO or whoever's directing engineering to be open-minded. But usually the best way is to prove that it can work. And then if they don't accept, then maybe on the side start working with functional programming, and then come back a week later and be like, okay, well, I did solve the problem using Java, but I also did this prototype on the side, and it runs twice as fast, and blah, 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 and then just show that it can work. And slowly, you'll get some momentum, hopefully, and you'll be able to introduce more FP in the company.
So I guess if I were to kind of dissect the two kind of experiences, right? I think, to me, the takeaway is let data speak for itself, right? In both the cases, you have, like in your case, you guys decided to take 2 months, try out something, and then use the data of who's reached where, how the code is maintainable, et cetera, that matters to the company, and make a case for it. In your case, it was about, let's not run right now to the CTO, let's build something in the side, which is not really mission critical at this point, but actually collect some data, get some expertise, and then kind of convince the management about it. So I guess that probably is the general purpose answer. Yeah, I guess so what you're saying is each company would have some kind of in-house products, in-house tools, in-house things that needs to be done. And that's a good platform for experimenting with new ideas, new languages, new paradigms. And maybe that gives the confidence to try it out then on a mainstream project. Yeah.
There's a two aspect though. The question is functional programming. Actually, doing functional programming in your existing programming language, I don't think anybody will complain about that though. I mean, but I think becomes interest challenges when you're switching languages.
Can you use the mic, please? Because I think people are start leaving. No, there's more time for dinner. Now, just that other people can hear, else they will zone out, right? Mic. Sorry.
So yeah, the point what I want to emphasize is like most of the companies, we do a lot of in-house prototypes or proof of concepts kind of thing, where a great amount of energy and time was invested in using the native languages or the kind of languages like Java or typical. I hardly, in my experience, 10 years experience in the industry, hardly could anybody could able to come up with a concept of a functional program. Functional programming does exist, and these things makes things much more simpler too, and in terms of scalability, fault tolerance, or in terms of what are the power the functional programming is bringing into, like, this is what we are spending a lot of time in the conventional programming like techniques. We are building up systems which are fault tolerant, which are like high availability systems and scalable systems. So we are doing conventional, spending a lot of energy over there. So there's nobody there to speak out like what is the potential that true functional programming is going to bring into picture, like awareness, like this is the conference. I was into functional programming for the last few months, like out of my own hobby, I was looking into the what is the true kind of thing this functional programming is. Why is that WhatsApp, why is that Facebook, everybody is talking about this functional programming, like. So this made me look into those aspects. That is what I felt like, yeah, this is what the technology or the developers or whoever is driving the technology has to think about it and start experimenting all functional programming languages and techniques and try to adapt to the functional. Of course, it is not like I'm not totally denying the native programming or the conventional programming, because everything goes in hand in hand, like some faults of some pieces of some gaps, some languages are going to fit into easily into other. So it is not like everything fits into one gap. But awareness is something like we need to bring it in-house through what we are already doing, okay? But a proactive role has to be taken by the people who are real passionate enough to try out this and showcase it to the other people so that they can gain confidence.
So even before you go to the management, the bigger point is right. There awareness? Are people going to try out things like this?
Exactly.
And that is probably a bigger challenge.
So right
before
now,
tackling the management.
Right now, what I see is all this limited to the startups. Like in Bangalore, most of the startups are the guys who are thinking differently and trying to experiment different kinds of. They have the success and the failures over there, but what is the thing that they are trying? This is a kind of awareness is not finding in the industry. Like industry, they always stick to the like one kind of coding guidelines and one kind of programming paradigm, like which is I don't think it is going to work. It's not going to work out if this continues for more time like this. Like
so, I just wanted to add to that. Right, I think. I think we're in a good place right now because it's unreasonable to expect an enterprise to adopt functional programming because you don't have the resources to do that. At least in the Bay Area, you know that there are people, but it's simply impossible for me to run a company if I don't have programmers, right? So I would choose old language any day over choosing a functional programming language if I wouldn't get the people for it. But the good thing is that if you are enthusiastic and you know a bunch of people, then you can, and you know what problem needs to be solved, you can solve it on your own as a separate company and then sell off the solution to them. The environment is very conducive to solving small problems and giving it to people, right? So you don't even have to, if you think the problem is big enough, if you think the cost benefit is worth it, right? But if you just want to write functional programming for the sake of it, then maybe you shouldn't be doing it in the enterprise, right? Maybe you should do it on your own.
There's a couple of aspects to this, right? I mean, there's a fear factor in here, right? Nobody gets fired to select an IBM product, for an example, right? There's a safety plays a role. I mean, lots of interesting psychology goes up. They're very much cultural as well. But one of the pattern I have seen successful, because that's what we do, that's a company, that was our job to see whether Scala adoption is picking up. And the places where I've seen it's been really successful is where somebody evangelized inside the company. If you care about your passionate event, you have to stay, be a leader inside the company. Because last thing you want to do is go to management, say you want to use this functional programming thing, we want to pick Erlang, Scala, whatever, and by the way, let's hire 50 consultants to solve that problem. You cannot do that, that's a no-win scenario. So data-driven, that's a huge thing. I have seen places where people took off in weekend, cranked out a code in your language, Monday demo to a team, say, hey, I solved this problem in 3 days. And team completely switched to Clojure or Scala. So, I mean, someone needs to be inside the company who can address this fear factor of management. Yes, I can take the responsibility, or I can lead this team to Haskell. I think that's very critical for us.
It's not just the fear factor of management. It's, as you said, you need someone to evangelize, but you also, before you even start evangelizing to management, you really need to convince the rest of the people that are going to have to end up working on this that this is what they want to be working on as well. So when we were moving to Erlang, Sam and I were in Canberra and the rest of our team were over in New York, and I took an opportunity of a trip over to New York to sort of convince all the other developers first that this was the way they want to go. And when you can present a united front to management and say, we all think this is the way to go, I think that's a much stronger message than, hey, I've got this crazy idea, and the rest of your colleagues looking at you going, what the, he never mentioned that to us. I think that's another element. It's not just a question of getting the decision makers on board, it's a question of getting the other people who it's going to impact directly on board and convincing them that they should be also helping you to convince management.
Right, I think the couple of people waiting, sure.
So I have less of a technical question and more of a history/community question. So Lisp is probably the oldest functional language probably invented in the 60s. I have less of experience with functional programming. So I'm curious to know why Lisp is where it is today. It's not, while its ideas are around both Common Lisp and MIT Lisp, are not seen in production. We don't hear of companies using it. I've heard somebody speak of the community as being toxic. So I'm just curious to know, you know, why things have turned out this way, if people do know about it.
I think one of the factor, I would be incorrect in some information here, so I apologize beforehand. One of the factor I think that played a huge role, I mean, remember, always not the best language always wins. I mean, there are lots of interesting factors in there. I mean, for Lisp, I think one of the biggest problem is that, or any X language there, for an example, is that if I want to pick it up, how does the ecosystem looks like? I mean, do I have to write my own logging library or HTTP library out there? The new incarnation of Lisp, which is a Clojure, I think has a much better, a brighter future because of the selection of the platform, for an example, JVM, and it suddenly have, I don't have to write another HTTP library because I just can use out there whatever written for Java. I think that's one of the critical factors that played a huge role.
I think one of the problems with historical Lisp was you had much more primitive machines that it was trying to run on, and Lisp's primary selling point, such as it was that you could create a new language to solve your problems. And the sort of Lisp response was when people would say, well, that's great, but honestly, I don't need that many languages. I just need this Atari to do something. And the Lisp response was, buy a Lisp machine. Come on, have some decency here. So, you know, nowadays you can have languages that take more inefficient routes to performing computation while saving programmer time. So, you know, nowadays you can say, you know, I'm going to make a special purpose language that does this thing, and it's going to take more CPU time, but I've got effectively unlimited CPU time for this particular thing that I'm doing, so it works out. But it's also why you don't see Lisp nowadays in, say, high-performance computing or in physics simulation, because you still need to access the machine in an incredibly efficient way. It's just that now Lisp, Clojure, which is really the only one that survived because it doesn't have the worst people in the world surrounding it. Common Lisp is a really interesting language, but a lot of the Common Lisp community is very elitist. Is probably the nicest way of putting that. And unless you happen to be damaged in some way and enjoy that, you're going to tend to stay away from Common Lisp. But you know, to the point you made earlier, not all the best technology wins out. You know, I study a lot of historical engineering because I work on these sorts of systems that have really bad consequences when they fail, and you just don't have that many examples in software. So I study the space race quite a bit. And one of my favorite examples is the first stage rockets in the lift engines. That's the thing at the very bottom. So if you think of the Apollo rocket or the unbuilt Soviet rocket, it's the real big part. The Soviets, what they were going to do was build a hyper-efficient engine so they could have a smaller rocket, but it took longer to develop. I won't go into the details of how it's more efficient, but the American approach was, just make it bigger and louder. And it was way more expensive, it was way less efficient, but it worked quickly. And you know, Russia never got to the moon, the US did, and then we all stopped going to the moon for reasons that I don't fully understand. But it's that idea of, you know, even if it is 10% better, is the time that it takes to get that 10% worth it? And I think historically the answer for Lisp was no. I don't need my own special purpose language. I need to be able to program this computer that I have.
I think one of the big problems that he noted is really the community. The Lisp's curse is like something real where everyone's kind of a purist and they don't want beginners to be joining. And if they don't agree with something, they just fork and create their own Lisp. So there's like 600,000 Lisps out there. And which one are you supposed to pick? If you pick Common Lisp, then you get the worst community. Well, the worst. This is recorded, right? uh-oh. but yeah, the community is not as amazing as the Erlang community, let's say. So I think that's kind of the main problem that happened there. But it's the same thing in other communities, like for instance, Erlang. We had a discussion this year at the Erlang factory in San Francisco about trying to help beginners joining the language. And some people, which are pretty famous in the community, still argued about that it's already easy, we don't need to do more. And it was kind of shocking to hear that when we're trying to grow the community and get more people to do functional programming and Erlang and all that, that some people still kind of, they want to keep it for kind of the elite people that know and keep that knowledge in a closed circle. So I think for Lisp, that's kind of what happened, and everyone has just been rewriting their own Lisp, so that doesn't help adoption.
Cool. I think we have a question.
Not necessarily about functional programming as such, but about new generation of programming languages, right? The only thing that has got a larger number than the number of programming languages is the number of package managers that they write for it, right? And this is a major problem when it comes to tooling, because essentially a lot of developer time is wasted on building very similar infrastructure. Yes, there might be a slight advantage, like you use a curly brace instead of a square bracket for listing your dependencies, but it doesn't seem like a major improvement. And say Nix tried to make common ground for everybody, but not many people seem to be interested in throwing away their language-specific package manager and like moving to a common package manager. Do you think this will ever be resolved in the future? Because for older systems, right, all you needed to do was type /configure make install. That's how I learned Linux, right, pretty much. And now it's some rebar, some mix, some cabal, right? I mean, and for every new language, just to understand how do I install the library, I need to go up and learn for 1 hour more, right? Where do you think this is heading?
So the Industrial Revolution is fascinating because it really got started because people thought, you know what, screws should all be the same size. So before the Industrial Revolution, you would have these screws, and they were all radically different. So everybody that was building something would have to hire a guy that all made screws. And every new project, every new bridge, everything, all custom made. And then you sort of had this clear value proposition to having standardized parts. And right now in software, we haven't found our Industrial Revolution. We're all still running out there. We're all craftsmen. We're in small guilds. We hate the potters across town. Eventually, we will random walk our way into standardized pieces. And I think part of that random walk is everybody saying, hey, this has a minor flaw. I'm going to build my own package manager, or my own Lisp, or my own compiler. You know, eventually, I think we will just sort of stumble on to standardized pieces. But where we are now, I don't think within our lifetimes, we will necessarily see that result. Technological change is slow. You know, it's faster than it used to be. We're not spending 2,000 years improving the point of a spear, but we still do take quite a while to improve things. And that sucks. I wish it were different.
Yeah, I think it's kind of unfortunate, especially for Erlang. The packet managers are non-existent, really. I think in the last 4 years, there's maybe like five that were created somehow, and that like five people use. To actually get that working, you need like an effort of the whole community, or have some sort of foundation that will guide and fund this packet manager. And I think Elixir has been kind of doing a good job at that part compared to Erlang, but it is definitely a problem that needs to be solved, and I hope it gets solved during our lifetimes, because at least for Erlang, like these days, there's the mainstream build tool is Rebar, but there's also Rebar 3 that works with some package, some others doesn't work, there's Erlang MK, and then there's a bunch of other stuff. There's plugins to try to make them work together. It's kind of a mess, and then in the end, it just makes the adoption way harder for someone, because like you said, you need to spend 2 days to try to understand how to build the release to put your application in production, and it really shouldn't be that way.
And the challenge there is that's Erlang focused. You know, if you want to do Erlang and Python and C++ and Java,
you've
got four different things there. You know, for a while it seemed like maybe AutoConf would be the solution, but when you build the all-seeing, all-knowing thing, it's terrible. You know, it's general purpose to the point of being absurd, and I honestly don't know what the solution there is.
But to that point, I mean, dependency management in general is a very hard problem to solve. I mean, it's not a trivial problem. Any language for that matter, right? JavaScript, if you see, is struggling with that problem big time. I mean, any language we pick has that big challenge.
So Brian sort of touched on this, but one of the particular problems that package management faces, it's not really clear where it should live either. You've got Rebar and Erlang MK and stuff, which are language specific things, and then you've got things like CPAN and stuff for Perl and what have you. But you've also got sort of OS level stuff like RPM and deb packages, which are kind of trying to more or less do the same thing, and they're trying to do it in a general case for all sort of packages, but that means that they sort of miss out on particularly useful features of the language, and similarly the language ones are filling that niche, but they're useless for the other languages. And that's, I'm not proposing any kind of solution for this. That's just another reason that possibly Brian's right, that we might all be in our cold graves before anyone actually figures this out properly.
What I want to ask is what would this solution even look like? I can't really, perhaps I'm too young, but I can't really understand how a package management system across different languages and systems would sort of work together and look like. Isn't the fragmentation already too high?
That is exactly what I was about to say. I mean, it will become like the XKCD comic.
But then the problem to solve is that for each language, if the package management system is good, then tying it all together with just a bash script is enough, right? I mean, what is the pain point? Is the pain point that within languages the package management systems are not good enough? But like for Haskell, you have Cabal and you have Stack and whatnot, which is, like he said, a fundamental problem with the nature of dependency itself. It's not really that people who are behind Haskell couldn't design a decent package management system, right? It's just that it's hard. So is that the question, or are you talking about across languages, if I want something installed in one place, that's the problem that you want to solve?
I was talking about across languages. That's why I brought Nix as an example over there. Because over here, essentially the problem with multiple tooling, right, is, for example, I work at a slightly larger company, and a bunch of N ports are open, and like 10 tools are open, and probably, yeah, you can't arbitrarily git download from arbitrary websites.
But isn't the current way that we're trying to approach this solution, trying to use orchestration tools like Chef or Salt or Puppet or Write Your Own, but, I mean, is that the answer?
So that partly helps. I mean, at the risk of making an N plus one package manager which tries to unify the N package manager.
But
right?
I don't even think we should
something
try to
like,
do that.
No, what I mean to say is, if you take something like Lua, a very small embeddable language, and wrote a package manager in it, I'm not suggesting that we do it, and this is hardly going to be like 300 KB extra along with, and it is one package manager that works for every language. I'm talking about package managers and not build systems. I understand that build systems might require language-specific features. Yeah, I'm talking about package managers. I made a mistake by referring to Mix. I meant Hex, Elixir, this thing, right? And Cabal, I meant Cabal install, not Cabal. Right. So having these package managers seems like an NPM, right? I mean,
no,
probably
I
it's
understand.
Not necessarily a good answer, but it is an answer. Just putting n number of directories inside directories. You take that and move on, pretty much.
Because whatever. Resources are cheap enough for you to do that. But, I think it's okay to have lots of different languages and different ecosystems and just have really figured out things within the language. Within the language ecosystem to get things working, but I think the problem is maybe hard enough for me to understand how everything will work together itself is so hard. The only way I can think of doing it is I'll do it manually using a bash script. I can't even think of what else I would want to replace it with, because anything that I replace it with, I would lose the ability to customize things, or I would lose the ability to specify something that is ecosystem specific, right? So I don't know.
So let's just agree that we're not going to solve this problem. Just move on. I think a gentleman over there has been waiting for a long time, so let's kind of quickly get to him.
My question is a little maybe off-beat here. I mean, maybe I'll be the bad guy. All of you have shipped systems, worked on production systems using functional languages. So my question is, what are the features in functional languages that you don't like? Right, each of the languages, whether it's Erlang or Haskell or tooling, like tooling, for instance, if I pick, try and find out how to do debugging with common Lisp, you'll tear your hair out. Somebody says go get Slime, somebody says go get LispWorks. So my question is two part. One, what are the personally, individually, each of you that you do not like in the languages, functional languages that you work in? Second, what are the things in the tooling that you would like to see better for the current languages that you're using? So in no particular order, I mean, none of that is more priority, but I just want to understand your, because all of you have shipped systems in functional languages, so I wanted to get your perspective on those things.
Can I just paraphrase your question a little bit?
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
So we'll just go in this order. Each person, just A, tell what's your favorite functional programming language, and then what is the one thing that you would like to change about that language, and then what is the one thing that you would like to change about the tooling in the language?
Okay.
Right, so three questions in one question.
I work with Erlang in production. If there was one change I could do to language, it would probably to have a way to have a limit on message queues so that you don't have to implement back pressure wherever you have asynchronous calls. And then the biggest problem in the tooling, I would say it's build tools.
So yeah, I think you're going to get three Erlings in a row as favorite language here. there we go, problem solved. The message queue length thing is an interesting one, although I'm not sure what a good solution for that would be is the thing that wouldn't complicate the language further, which isn't to say it's not a problem. You're absolutely right. So just to give a slightly different answer, then probably the biggest problem we found in rolling Erlang out to production is that there is very poor support in it for running it as a Unix-style service. So there's a bunch of behaviors you expect from a Unix service. You expect to be able to start and stop it. You expect to be able to send it a sighup to rotate the logs. You expect it to hold on to the terminal when you start it until it's fully started and then return an error code. And basically none of that is built into Erlang. As a shameless plug, we wrote an open source program called ERLD that will provide all of that, so you should definitely look it up if you're running Erlang in production. What was the third thing? Oh yeah, tooling. What I'd like to see done much better in Erlang is the release hand, and kind of goes to the build system, but is specifically the release handling. Erlang's got this whole sort of system theoretically in place that allows you to build a release, and that will provide you with hot code upgrading and all these other magical things, and no one I've talked to has ever really used it successfully in large scale because it's really difficult and not particularly, I don't think it's brilliantly put together for what it's supposed to be doing. I'm not suggesting I could do it better, but it's no one seems to be able to use that well. So I'd like to see that done really well.
It takes a lot of discipline to get right.
There's my problem, right?
Yeah, it's real easy to screw up. You need to have a system around the system to get it right, to detect that you've incorrectly upgraded things. Once you have that in place, once you've spent all that money, which I'm sure Ericsson has private tools for that, and yeah, Adroll has private tools for that, it's real sweet. But before that point, it's just real bad.
Yeah.
So I'll talk about Haskell. So from, I think the ability to reason about memory consumption and usage is very important. It's not a problem that we've really hit right now, but it is something that is definitely going to be a problem for us going forward. From a tooling point of view, I would like to see faster, much faster compile times. I mean, especially for larger, the more complicated somehow, and the nicer the abstraction seems to be, the more the compile time is. And that's, I want it to be more like a dynamic programming language. I just want to run it and see it. Also more support around a distributed kind of model, allowing things like hot loading and stuff. Which is technically perhaps not even possible with a language like Haskell, but approaching that in whatever way possible would be nice.
Cool.
So let's see, my current favorite language that I don't actually work with is Rust, but it's not really a functional programming language. It's an imperative language with a lot of compile time guarantees. So I won't talk about Rust, but if anyone wants to talk about it at dinner, I would love to do that. It's a fascinating language, but it's not functional. It is very much imperative with some functional niceties put in.
It's dynamic C is the best way to describe it.
You know, it does actually have strong static typing. So its primary focus is memory safety. And yeah, so it had a linear type system so that you could say, well, this bit of memory that you're able to represent in the type system is only used once, and then they backed away from linear typing, but I think now it's multi-value resource typing, something like that. It's got a particular name, it's a particular logic. but it's relatively new and it's not a functional language. My favorite functional programming language is Erlang. So I forget what the other questions are supposed to be.
What's one thing that you would like to change about your favorite programming language and one thing that you would like to improve in the tooling?
Got it. I would like to remove the limit on the number of atoms that the system can have. So I am very, very interested in Erlang systems that have incredibly long service lifetimes, and there are a couple of fun ways to knock over an Erlang box. One is to dynamically create atoms. And my later point will get into this. If you dynamically create an atom, there are only about 2 million of them that are allowed in the system. There's an atom table that is effectively just a C array. And once you fill that thing up, if you go past the end, you crash the Erlang VM. So your entire system goes offline. I would fix that. It's relatively easy to fix. We've had, or relatively from the semantics model point of view to the message queue problem, easy to fix. We just have not paid anyone to implement it. What I would like to fix in the language's tooling, the Erlang compiler is real dumb. It's very simple. It does not do much analysis of the program. And because it doesn't do much analysis of the program, its optimization is real dumb. So for instance, one easy win would be constant folding. So a lot of time in Erlang programs, you'll see things that are macros that are really just a constant, but Erlang macros are textual substitutions, and they'll be a constant in terms of their function that then computes a value. And then over and over and over again in your program, that will be computed. So then you'll see people that will come through and they'll do that manually, and then they'll put a comment off to the side and say, here's the computation that this is. If you just had constant folding, you wouldn't have to do that. But ERLC is designed, as most Erlang things are, to be simple and obviously correct, because it's from an earlier era where computers were very difficult to have these sort of static guarantees. So a nicer compiler is my answer.
My favorite language is Scala. That's what I use here. So where should I start? So one of the things that I really like to improve as C getting better is the type inference functionality and having some sort of effect system so that I can track the mutations through the application. And the tooling is the binary compatibility checks, but also the upgrades also. As this language going to mainstream, we are having larger and larger applications, figuring out whether, because I want my language to evolve, get new features, get excited, and also kind of balance the engineering bits and figure out whether it's incompatible.
So I'm going to actually answer the original question, which is one thing I don't like about some functional programming languages. So I'm going to speak a little, I'm going to talk a little bit about closure. And everyone keeps telling you about all these great aspects of immutable data structures, and like, you know, you can associate onto a map and it doesn't affect the first one, I mean the original one, but that actually comes with its own set of problems, which you'll get into, which is that it generates a lot of garbage. Like, especially if you're like taking a map and you're, so if you actually look into the closure code, there is a lot of like optimizations that people have tried to make to like make sure that, you see that you're associating the same keys over and over, it'll like, you know, reuse, like it'll not hold a pointer to your older map and stuff like that. But at least the first thing you'll always do in like a closure problem is you'll find like all these places where you're mutating a map like in a row, and you'll immediately make it a transient, which, it takes away from the some of the benefits you'd expect.
So with regard to immutable data structures creating garbage, have you heard about Rust? that's a cute way of saying it, but because the language in its semantic model has memory as a first class concern, you can have immutable data structures that don't require any runtime allocation. They only require allocation if you happen to modify the structure, and then you only ever have one owner for something. So there is no need for a garbage collector, because you can statically say that the lifetime of this piece of memory is such and such a thing and such a function. So if I have two threads that are just passing the same immutable structure back and forth, if I choose to modify that structure, Rust will guarantee that either I have to force a copy, and so the threads have two copies of the thing, or they only modify them at once, or one at a time. So you never have to, you know, copy the thing and then you have two copies of memory, unless you explicitly do that. I think with regard to garbage collection, you know, it for a long time it seemed like the right thing to do, because we had lived through manual memory management where the compilers had to run on very primitive machines, so they couldn't guarantee much about the manual memory, and you just had to have, you know, this sort of like reasoned model in your mind. And now we've gotten to the point where we've invented enough math, where we have fast enough computers, where it turns out you can actually start to statically analyze this sort of thing. So I think immutable data structures are real nice, and in garbage collected languages, they have that exact problem. But I think in the future, and I don't think Rust is necessarily the language of the future, I think it might end up being a Lisp type language, where people go, oh, Rust was so good. But its features end up being in every language. So I think we'll start to see new classes of language coming where you can statically analyze memory, and you'll have immutable data structures that don't spew garbage all over the place.
Fingers crossed, I guess.
Yeah, we might all be dead by that time, but it will happen.
All right, I think we are at 7, so that's pretty much the end of the panel. So if you have any other questions that you were not able to ask, that's okay. We're going to have dinner, and then you have more time to ask people specific questions that you know were not able to ask so far. So thanks the gentlemen over here in the panel. Appreciate all the insights. Thank you. And thank you guys for sticking around. Dinner, I guess, is ready, so we can have dinner, and see you guys tomorrow at 9 a.m. sharp.